Well, welcome everybody to St John's. As we gather tonight, we acknowledge the Yagara and the Turrbal people, who are the custodians of this land which was never ceded, and we pay respects to their elders, past and present, and pay respects to any Aboriginal or Torres Strait Islander people who are with us tonight. It's great to have you here tonight and to welcome those who join us on YouTube. It's a very interesting and different way to do all sorts of things during these COVID days. I welcome amongst us Claire Moore, who's the UNAA Queensland President, and Danelle Davis, who's the immediate past President. The award recipients, congratulations to you, and it's great to have you with us, and thank you all for joining us. As we gather tonight, we need to acknowledge that we've received sad news today of the death of Richard Cowley. Richard was one of the people who put the International Day of Peace on the map in Brisbane. After corresponding with Jeremy Gilley, who worked with world leaders to have the International Day of Peace recognised each year on the 21st of September, he reached out to the Brisbane peace groups to work together on a project to support the resolution. It was from an initial meeting that led to arranging to chat with Margaret Reynolds, who suggested, "How about a youth peace parliament?" They were held annually for 5 years, with many Brisbane and regional schools sending students. And we say Vale Richard, who will be missed, and send our condolences to his family. It's great to be able to use technology these days. And so on Zoom, we have with us tonight Dr. Tilman Ruff and Dr. Gillian Triggs, who should be appearing before you, and they can have a wave. Welcome. Greetings from Brisbane. This is our ninth lecture, can you believe? And it's a great privilege for us at the Cathedral Community to host this very important lecture. Of course, it hangs on the United Nations International Day of Peace, and Annette Brownlee from the UNAA Queensland, who is the Peace and Security Program Manager, is going to read the Secretary General's message. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. I would like to acknowledge too the traditional custodians of this land and pay my respects to their elders past and present. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, here in the cathedral and via live stream on YouTube, I've been given the honour of delivering on behalf of the Secretary General of the United Nations his message for the 2020 International Day of Peace. He states, "The International Day of Peace is devoted to urging warring parties everywhere to lay down their weapons and work for harmony. As the COVID-19 pandemic continues to ravage the world, this call is more important than ever. That is why I appealed for a global ceasefire in March. Our world faces a common enemy, a deadly virus, is causing immense suffering, destroying livelihoods, contributing to international tensions, and exacerbating already formidable peace and security challenges. The focus of this year's International Day of Peace is shaping peace together, which you will see on the front of your programs. In that spirit, and to mark the 75th anniversary, the United Nations is bringing people together for a global conversation about shaping our future and forging peace in trying times. In these days of physically distancing, we may not be able to stand next to each other, but we must still stand together for peace. And together, I know we can and we will build a more just, sustainable and equitable world.
Thank you, Annette. One of the evolutionary things that happened to the peace lecture a few years ago was it was twinned with the announcement of the local agents of peace and that great piece of synergy. So I now invite Associate Professor Marianne Hansen to lead us through this year's presentation. Thank you.
Good evening, ladies, gentlemen, friends, distinguished guests. I too would like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land on which we stand tonight. My name is Marianne Hansen, and I'm pleased to welcome you very warmly to the Celebrating Local Agents of Peace Award. The University of Queensland and Rotary International have made strong commitments to furthering peace and justice in our world. And I'm proud to have been the director of the Rotary Peace Centre for 10 years. I'm delighted to see so many Rotarians in the audience tonight, together with our current director, Associate Professor Morgan Brigg. Also present tonight are our Rotary Peace Fellows, an outstanding group of students engaged with these issues at UQ. As we celebrate the 75th anniversary of the establishment of the United Nations, let's remember that many Rotarians were present at that creation, showing an early link between Rotaries and the UN's principles. This year also marks the somber commemoration of the 75th anniversary of the atomic bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And again, the UN and now prominent Rotarians are working to abolish these most destructive weapons of mass destruction. Some years ago, we felt it was important to recognize individuals and organizations in Queensland who work to promote peace at a local, global, or regional level. And we are very happy that we could do this within the broader celebration of the International Day of Peace, so wonderfully hosted in this cathedral. We believe that the everyday efforts made by these people should be applauded. They are often the unsung heroes who go about making the world a better place, addressing injustice and trauma, and promoting respect, tolerance, and inclusivity. In a world where the voices of conflict and hatred are all too often heard, it is important to give voice to those who graciously strive to uphold the ideals of peace, usually without any recognition. I'm delighted to share this podium tonight with Mr. Doug Sinclair from Rotary District 9630, and Doug will be presenting our awards tonight. Our two recipients are Sister Wendy Flannery and QPAST, the Queensland Program of Assistance to Survivors of Torture and Trauma. Sister Wendy Flannery has been involved in the search for climate justice, women's education, human rights, and anti-nuclearism for decades, and she has worked with the United Nations on these issues. QPAST provides a range of important services to people from refugee and migrant backgrounds, including those who have survived torture or war-related trauma. You will find more information on our two recipients in the banners on either side here. I would now like to call on Sister Wendy Flannery to receive this recognition as an agent of peace.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. I'd also like to acknowledge the Turrbal people and their neighbours who were the first ones to live in this wonderful place. And I have a sense that the spirit of their ancestors is with us tonight as well. I also want to take this opportunity to thank St. John's Cathedral for their generous and supportive hospitality. A lot of things I've been involved in over the years couldn't have happened if it wasn't for St. John's Cathedral and their very welcoming presence. And of course to thank Rotary and for the Rotary Peace Program and the wonderful young people who are here tonight doing their studies there at my old alma mater, UQ. I have just one thing I'd like to mention tonight. There's a group of about eight of us women here in Brisbane connected to WILF, the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom. And we're trying to support a particular aspect of the ICAN program, the International Campaign for the Abolition of Nuclear Weapons. And it's to get local government councils to endorse the treaty and let the Australian government know that they're endorsing it and they want the government to sign and ratify that treaty. So everyone here tonight could actually support that initiative by going along to your local government councillor and encouraging them to endorse the treaty. That's the one thing I think everybody here tonight could do. So just to conclude, just after I heard from Diana about the award, I found on a little piece of paper on my desk a Zen proverb. And the proverb is, no seed ever sees the flower. And that's what peacemaking is on about, I think. It's about continuing to sow seeds, knowing that the flowers will bloom, even if we're not around to see them. Thank you.
Thank you, Sister Wendy. I would now like to call on Associate Professor Ignacio Correa Vélez from QPAST to receive this recognition as an agent of peace.
Thank you, everyone. Now, I have been asked to speak only for 3 minutes as an Latin American. That's a really difficult task, but I'll do my best. Let me acknowledge first the traditional custodians of this land and pay my respect to the elders, past, present, and emerging, and also recognizing that for many thousands of years, these have been places of recovery and healing. As of June 2020, 170 countries have become parties to the 1984 UN Convention Against Torture. Sadly, political oppression, persecution, and torture are still widely spread across the world. Torture impacts on individuals, families, and communities. QPAST was established 25 years ago to support the recovery of refugee survivors of torture and trauma so that they can heal, belong, and thrive in a just Australian community. QPAST exists to ensure that trauma and torture are not a barrier to survivors' social and economic well-being. I humbly receive this award not only on behalf of QPAST board and our fantastic staff, but most importantly, on behalf of our clients and communities from refugee backgrounds, on behalf of their resilience, their individual and community strengths, their hopes for recovery and justice, their dreams for a better future, their aspirations to be able to fully participate as equal citizens in the Australian community. Thank you. This is their award. Thank you.
Thank you again to QPAST and to Sister Wendy for all the wonderful work that you do. That concludes this section of the event. I'd like to hand back now to Dr. Peter Catt. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary Ann, and thank you for the privilege of hosting that award ceremony. It's a source of great hope to have local heroes. We're going to have a change of pace, which is a really good idea. We're going to listen to Leah Cottrell and Dave Maguire, who are going to offer us a musical reflection. So thank you. Thank you, Leah and Dave. It was magic. It's amazing acoustic in this place, isn't it? It's great. Our first speaker, Dr. Tilman Ruff, will say some words about nuclear disarmament, and then he will introduce the keynote address by Dr. Julian Triggs. Dr. Tilman Ruff is a public health and infectious disease physician. He has been co-president of International Physicians for the Prevention of Nuclear War since 2012 and is the co-founder and founding international and Australian chair of the International Campaign to Abolish Nuclear Weapons, ICAN. In 2017, ICAN was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize, which we hope Donald Trump doesn't get. just by the way, ICAN got the Nobel Peace Prize in 2017 for its work to draw attention to the catastrophic humanitarian consequences of any use of nuclear weapons and for its groundbreaking efforts to achieve a treaty-based prohibition of such weapons. It's with great privilege, I thank Tilman for offering this for us and hand over to him.
I'm deeply honoured to speak with you today and to introduce Professor Gillian Triggs. I do so from the land of the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation, and I offer my respect and thanks to their elders for their continuing custodianship from which we all benefit. 75 years ago, the nuclear age erupted with the Trinity plutonium nuclear explosion, followed a few weeks later by the radioactive incineration of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, by what these days would be considered small, tactical-sized nuclear weapons. Since then, for everything that lives and breathes on this planet, as William Faulkner said in his Nobel Prize speech in 1950, there are no longer problems of the spirit. There is only the question, when will I be blown up? Within days of becoming aware of the extent of the utter devastation of Hiroshima and the impossibility of effectively responding to the agonizing suffering of over 100,000 wounded, irradiated and burned people, the International Committee of the Red Cross called for the elimination of nuclear weapons. A few months later, in January 1946, the very first resolution of the newly formed United Nations General Assembly called for the elimination of atomic weapons. Yet 75 years on, despite endless unfulfilled promises, despite every nation being obligated to achieve nuclear disarmament, the sword of Damocles of the most acute existential threat we confront not only looms over all of us every hour of every day, but the danger of nuclear war is as great as it has ever been, and it is growing. Thousands of nuclear weapons are on hair trigger alert. Irresponsible leaders escalate nuclear threats, and all 9 nuclear-armed nations are spending profligate sums developing new, more dangerous nuclear weapons. Hard-won treaties that have constrained nuclear weapons development and numbers are being progressively trashed by the state we claim as our major ally, with barely a peep from our government. As the impacts of global heating really start to bite, the number of internationalized conflicts with risk of nuclear escalation is increasing sharply. Cyber attack creates escalating possibilities of triggering nuclear war by infiltrating and corrupting nuclear warning, command and control systems. That we are still here, living our lives most of the time as if these weapons didn't exist, is largely a matter of luck. There is an absolute and urgent necessity to eradicate these weapons before our luck runs out. Will it be the end of nuclear weapons or the end of us? It will be one or the other. Our best hope for reining in the world's worst weapons is the historic United Nations Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons. This not only for the first time categorically and comprehensively prohibits nuclear weapons, but also provides a framework, the only internationally agreed framework, for their elimination. It was for its contribution to this treaty that the Melbourne-born International Campaign to Abolish Nuclear Weapons in 2017 became the first Australian-born entity to win a Nobel Peace Prize. The treaty currently has 84 signatories and 44 ratifications, and can be expected to achieve the 50 ratifications needed for its legal entry into force before the end of this year. By early next year, just like biological and chemical weapons, landmines and cluster munitions, nuclear weapons will finally be prohibited under international law. Nuclear weapons have always been immoral. Soon they will be illegal. States that are serious about nuclear disarmament will join this treaty. I am grateful to Professor Triggs for writing the foreword in ICANN's 2019 report, Choosing Humanity, Why Australia Must Join the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons. Nuclear weapons are a profound human rights issue. The International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights is a key international human rights treaty with 173 states parties, including Australia. Article 6 of this convention addresses the right to life. In its 2018 general comment on Article 6, the most authoritative statement on states' obligations under this article, the UN Human Rights Commission states, and I quote, "The threat or use of weapons of mass destruction, in particular nuclear weapons, which are indiscriminate in effect and are of a nature to cause destruction of human life on a catastrophic scale, is incompatible with the respect for the right to life and may amount to a crime under international law," end quote. They also said that states, and I quote, "must also respect their international obligations to pursue in good faith negotiations in order to achieve the aim of nuclear disarmament and afford adequate reparation to victims whose right to life has been or is being adversely affected by the testing or use of weapons of mass destruction." The right to life, which nuclear weapons jeopardize not only for everyone alive today, but all future generations, is after all the precondition for the enjoyment of all other rights. I'm now delighted to introduce Professor Gillian Triggs to deliver the 2020 International Day of Peace lecture. A year ago, Professor Triggs was appointed by UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres as Assistant Secretary General to serve as the Assistant High Commissioner for Protection in the Office of the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees. In this role, Professor Triggs oversees UNHCR's vital work to protect the growing millions of refugees, internally displaced, stateless, and other vulnerable people. A Melbourne girl, Professor Triggs has a distinguished background as an academic and practicing lawyer, human rights advocate, and public policy expert. She's been Professor of Law at the University of Melbourne, Director of the British Institute of International and Comparative Law, Dean and Chalice Professor of International Law at the University of Sydney, and Acting Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Social Justice Commissioner. Of course, she's best known to Australians as the recent President of the Australian Human Rights Commission. There she copped the ire of some of our politicians for the most admirable of reasons, providing leadership with courage and integrity, most particularly in telling the truth of Australia's disturbing, ongoing, and severe violations of the rights of people seeking refuge, already traumatised and vulnerable, to whom we owe protection and compassionate care rather than indefinite incarceration and abuse. I know I speak for all of us in thanking you, Professor Triggs, for your courageous commitment to human rights and your inspiring leadership. We are all looking forward to your International Day of Peace lecture.
It's a pleasure for me to return to St John's Cathedral, Brisbane, where a few years ago I was able to take part in the loaves and fishes service. Thank you for the invitation to join you again, but this time virtually, to commemorate the 75th anniversary of the dropping of atomic bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, bringing to a definitive end the Second World War in the Pacific. This year also marks the 75th anniversary of the founding of the United Nations under a charter that declares the determination of member states to save succeeding generations from the scourge of war, which twice in our lifetime has brought untold sorrow to mankind. We, the peoples, being the language of the charter, founded the United Nations as the most universal, representative and authoritative international organization ever to be created, establishing an international order to give effect to the principles of the Charter. And thus began a new era in humankind's pursuit of peace and development. In future, conflicts were to be governed by the rule of law under the leadership of the 15-member Security Council, including the 5 permanent members, the United Kingdom, Russia, China, France and the United States. The Security Council was to have the power and the duty to determine the existence of any threat to the peace, breach of the peace, act of aggression, and make recommendations or decide what measures could be taken to maintain and restore international peace. This was the vision. The reality has been very different. Over the last 75 years, we've seen major conflicts in Korea, Vietnam, Afghanistan, Syria, Sudan, Somalia, Libya, Yemen, Myanmar, just to name a few. These conflicts have often been civil wars within countries or with close neighbours, rather than international conflicts. They're notable for being protracted and unresolved over many decades, unlike the relatively short First and Second World Wars. The war in Afghanistan, for example, has lasted 40 years, with hope in the last few days that preliminary peace talks will prove to be successful. These long-term modern conflicts have led to unprecedented numbers of asylum seekers, refugees, people displaced in their own country, or people who are stateless, over 80 million people globally, who are forcibly displaced by intercommunal violence and other root causes, such as poverty, food insecurity, gender inequality, climate change, and degraded environments. These global emergencies have now been joined by another global crisis. COVID-19 is a crisis superimposed on many others. The pandemic prompted the Secretary General of the United Nations to call for a global ceasefire in March and again in April this year, on the ground, to quote him, that there should be only one fight in our world today, our shared battle against COVID-19. And he observed that the virus does not care about nationality or ethnicity, factions or faith. He also warned that COVID-19 is having profound consequences on the most vulnerable people in the world, including those forcibly displaced, and on efforts to achieve international peace and security. The Security Council unanimously supported the Secretary General's call for a ceasefire for at least 90 days to enable the delivery of humanitarian assistance and medical evacuations. And 70 member states endorsed the Secretary General's call, along with religious leaders, regional partners, non-state actors, civil society, grassroots organisations. The practical results of this ceasefire call have been mixed, with the biggest impact shortly after it was announced. Sadly, in some instances where a ceasefire has been adopted, it's been very short-lived. There's been some good news. In Syria, the ceasefire in Idlib province, with over 1 million Syrians displaced there, has appeared largely to hold. Peace agreements have just been signed, as you will all know, between Israel, Bahrain and the United Arab Emirates. Sadly, in the Dominican Republic of the Congo, where 139 civil society organisations called for a complete ceasefire, intercommunal conflict continues. So too, conflict is almost constant in Niger, Burkina Faso, Mozambique. In the devastating civil war in Yemen, the conflict initially sparked, despite the call for a ceasefire. In Libya, again, calls for a ceasefire by the warring parties has nonetheless continued and indeed escalated. But then peace negotiations in Afghanistan have begun, while fighting there continues almost unabated. So in short, the vision of the UN Charter for prohibiting and responding to conflict has not been achieved over the last 75 years, reflecting, among many other causes, the inability of the Security Council to act once a single permanent member uses its veto to block action. Well, while we reflect today on the continuing challenges to achieving global peace, as a representative of the UN's refugee agency, I'd like to consider the consequences of conflict and other crises on the most vulnerable people in the world, the 26 million refugees and asylum seekers, the 50 million or so people displaced in their own countries by conflict, and the countless millions who remain stateless. As we reflect on the 75th anniversary of the bombings in Japan and of the creation of the UN Charter, today we also celebrate the 70th anniversary, or we will in a few months, of the 1951 Refugee Convention, in which over 140 countries have agreed that each of us has the right to seek asylum from persecution, conflict, and discrimination, and that there's an absolute prohibition on the forced return to that place of persecution, conflict, and danger. In the late 1940s and early 50s, the international community had been determined in negotiating the Refugee Convention to ensure access to asylum for, at that time, an estimated 2 million people who were called the displaced in the aftermath of the Second World War and the Holocaust. In stark contrast to the dimension of the humanitarian needs of those times, today we're dealing with 80 million people in need of international protection, an unprecedented number on the move throughout the world, a number that increases every year. 2 years ago, the international community recognised the need to respond collaboratively and with global solidarity and reached an agreement on a strategy for joint rather than unilateral action, the Global Compact on Refugees. Under this compact, the overwhelming majority of nations agreed that they would share equitably the burdens and responsibilities for refugees so that countries hosting refugees or IDPs are supported by other countries. Perhaps the best example of this need for international support is Turkey, a country that has hosted nearly 4 million refugees for the last 10 years, refugees that have come mainly from the conflict in Syria. The Global Compact on Refugees also recognised the role of faith-based groups in fostering peaceful coexistence and in using their authority to advocate for refugees. Well, the compact is, of course, just more words. Will these words, like the vision of the United Nations Charter, remain inspiring sentiments, or can they be made concrete reality and implemented in practice? Last December, the Forum of Nations was held in Geneva, where governments, non-government organisations, the private sector, commercial bodies, educators, scholars, and civil society generally, made 1,400 pledges to assist refugees and those displaced or stateless, underscoring the need and recognition of the need for global collaboration. Who could possibly have imagined that within weeks of this very successful pledging conference last December, COVID-19 would so profoundly challenge the goal of global solidarity? Responses to the virus have been severe, leading to restrictive measures that have posed the most severe threats to the near unanimous international commitment to the fundamental norms of refugee protection agreed 7 decades ago. At the peak of national responses to COVID-19 in around April, May this year, about 168 nations fully or partially closed their borders, denying access to their territory for refugees, asylum seekers to make a claim for asylum. About 70 nations have completely suspended their asylum processes. In breach of the prohibition on forcible returns to a place of danger and persecution, UNHCR has credible evidence of boat pushbacks and forced returns to danger. We've all seen the TV footage by some governments with water cannons and bullets to prevent entry to safe lands, and the refusal by some states to disembark boats drifting at sea for weeks. In the case of Bangladeshi asylum seekers, recently it took 6 months at sea and 30 deaths before they were finally allowed to disembark in Aceh a few days ago in Indonesia. In addition to these restrictions, many seeking asylum and protection have been detained in immigration centres for protracted periods without access to courts, detention that is in danger of becoming arbitrary in breach of fundamental human rights, for no one may be detained arbitrarily without trial by their peers. Indeed, for the first time in its history, UNHCR was temporarily forced to suspend its resettlement programme, which is now, I'm pleased to say, slowly resuming as flights become available and countries start to open their borders. The justification for denying fundamental refugee rights, rights to asylum and rights to basic human rights in this time of COVID is often said to be because of the national priority of containing the pandemic. At the UN Refugee Agency, we fully support the right, indeed the responsibility of nations, to protect their borders and to protect public health in a pandemic. However, we urge nations to protect these rights and allow asylum seekers access to territory to make a claim for protection. In other words, this is not a binary question. Nations can do both, protect their borders and national health and ensure access to asylum by adopting reasonable and proportionate measures, such as quarantine, enabling access to information and referral through remote call centres, or using video conferencing such as this to access protection needs and to interview applicants for asylum. As the pandemic subsides, and it surely must, it's vital that all nations reopen their borders and resume their asylum processes. The risk is, we fear, that countries will entrench their more restrictive measures under the camouflage of the COVID-19 pandemic, with the result that international refugee law and 70 years of protection practices will have taken a step backwards. The picture is, of course, not an entirely negative one. Many states have responded humanely to refugee needs. And I mention one, Uganda, which has opened its borders a few weeks ago to 2,000 asylum seekers fleeing from a regional conflict, a generous act of humanity and one that is a standard bearer of best practice for many other countries throughout the world. Well, while thus far I've been emphasising the denial of legal rights under the Refugee Convention, there are also likely to be long-term social and economic consequences of COVID-19 for vulnerable people. The lockdowns have brought job losses, family tensions, spikes in gender-based violence. Over 1 billion children out of school has led to an increased incidence of child abuse and exploitation, a rise in child marriages, trafficking, and in mental illness. We've seen growing xenophobia and racism, and of course, global insecurity as part reflecting climate change and degradation of the environment. As refugees and those internally displaced typically depend on the informal economy, they are among the first to lose their jobs, rapidly becoming available to exploitation. What then does UNHCR do in the face of these legal and socio-economic challenges? Well, first and forward and foremost, UNHCR responds to emergencies. The High Commissioner for the Refugee Agency, Filippo Grandi, has asked us all to stand and deliver, to stay and deliver immediate support on the ground, to provide shelter, water, hygiene supplies and basic equipment, and increasingly importantly, cash assistance. Just by way of example, UNHCR has delivered 1 million bars of soap to sub-Saharan Africa in its fight against COVID-19. I returned just a few days ago from Greece and the island of Lesbos, just before the fires destroyed the overcrowded camp Moria on the island. Within a day or so, UNHCR was able to provide tents, water, and supplies to the many thousand who are now homeless. This UNHCR does across the world in emergencies in Burkina Faso, in the Sudanese floods, the Somali locust attacks, and the displaced millions in Colombia, Mexico, and Nicaragua, fleeing criminal gangs, political persecution, and corruption. We respond to the conflict in practical ways in Syria and responding to the explosion and economic losses for the host country, or for the country, Lebanon, which has been such a strong host country for refugees over the last 10 years. But beyond the immediate emergencies, UNHCR has some very particular roles. Perhaps the best known is its role in registering asylum seekers and assessing their refugee status and submitting the most vulnerable of them to resettlement countries for a new life. Sadly, resettlement places are very few. Of 26 million refugees, over 1 million will be in need of resettlement, and barely 70,000 places are available. This year, only 10,000 have been resettled. Not only are resettlement places far too few, but the prospects of voluntary returns to the country of origin are also slight. Particular examples, of course, are Myanmar and Syria. And perhaps a little known fact is that most refugees want to go home, but this is impossible in these protracted civil conflicts. But UNHCR is about finding sustainable solutions. A viable solution for the millions who can neither return home nor be resettled must be found. And I suggest that the solution, and a practical one, is for more inclusive national policies. For the reality is that most refugees and displaced peoples will remain where they've found a place of safety. More than ever in the context of COVID-19, nations need to be encouraged to include the most vulnerable in national social systems. Access to education, to health services, to employment and social services on an equal and non-discriminatory basis. Indeed, I believe inclusion is the fundamental challenge that faces us globally, along with preventative peace-building measures. And there are, of course, some wonderful examples of inclusion. Most countries have given access to education and health services to refugees and displaced people. And some countries like Costa Rica have expressly and legislatively ensured that refugees are included within their national social safety nets. Well, while COVID-19 has brought personal tragedy to millions, it's also stimulated some new opportunities. The pandemic has shown us, as no other global crisis has been able in the past, why we need to act together within the spirit of the compact. We cannot resolve crises alone. The drivers of conflict forcing displacement, poverty, inequality, poor health services, lack of employment opportunities, inadequate housing, limited access to education, and climate change. The vision of the compact, solidarity and responsibility sharing, have been confirmed by the pandemic. We must act multilaterally to prevent and respond to crises and conflict. COVID-19 has also prompted some new approaches to the root causes of conflict. The international financial institutions, such as the World Bank, are now providing grants, as distinct from traditional loans, to 15 countries most in need, so that funds are available to provide shelter, healthcare, and education. Above all, COVID-19 has shown us that we must integrate all people within the social safety nets of host nations, regardless of their legal status. We need to support self-reliance among refugee populations so that they're able to work. And nations such as Djibouti and Ethiopia have guaranteed the right to work for all refugees hosted in their countries. So too, COVID-19 has taught us how we can work together, yet remotely, introducing us to new technologies and new words. Zoom, WebEx, Teams, how to find the mute button, and chat boxes. COVID-19 has shown us that we can protect vulnerable people using these digital technologies. I've been touched in particular by creative efforts to ensure that children have access to education. In Mali, for example, a volunteer group found old radios with new batteries to provide access to education in remote parts of the country where children have been isolated by intercommunal conflict. Well, I'd like to conclude, if I may, by returning to the importance of faith-based groups working in local communities to support and include refugees. Many religious communities have supported the vision of the Global Compact for Refugees by addressing the root causes of conflict through peace building. And some examples are the Middle East Council of Churches that promotes public policies by avoiding sectarian and ideological approaches. The Jesuit Refugee Service encourages good relations among refugee and host communities, not always easy to achieve, as I've just seen on Lesbos Island. The Jordanian Hashemite Fund has created safe spaces for communities to come together to discuss peace initiatives. And recently, UNHCR, under the leadership of our High Commissioner, Philippa Grandi, has agreed with the global faith-based group Religions for Peace to establish an advisory council of religious leaders to pursue peace building with practical advocacy for social inclusion and cohesion, and to support local communities. Underpinning this initiative is the principle of welcoming the stranger. Through protection and hospitality, with respect and equality, a moral commitment that is deeply rooted in all major religions, Hindus, Buddhists, Jews, Muslims, and Christians. But perhaps I can finish by referring to the Matthew's Gospel that says, I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. Or in the letter to Hebrews, do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for by doing so, some have unknowingly entertained angels. Well, as we remember the bombings in Hiroshima and Nagasaki and the refugee convention nearly 70 years ago, we now have a blueprint for international solidarity in the Global Compact on Refugees. COVID-19 has shown us the vulnerability of health and social networks and prompted us, as the Secretary General of the United Nations has said, to build back better in the future. I hope that in the spirit of the Global Refugee Compact, we can agree together to welcome the stranger. Thank you all very much.
It's actually an honour to be able to acknowledge all of you as global citizens by being here tonight. But more importantly, being on Zoom, we are talking to global citizens all over the world. It is a privilege that we in Brisbane can say we are talking through our guest speakers what we can do for peace. We talk about the 75th anniversary, but do you realise this is the 9th Brisbane Peace Lecture? We are 9 years young. Just think what we can do when we are 75 years in a peaceful global society. I first of all got to thank our guest speaker. Not even on the horizon, over the horizon, but through Zoom has been with us. And you know what is great? Really important to me, that Dr. Julian Triggs has been recognised by the United Nations to be appointed as the Assistant Secretary General, probably the highest position of any Australian in the United Nations. Wouldn't it be great if our government also gave that acknowledgement? That you and me... And she did challenge us to understand what it means for conflict and war. She asked us to be together in global solidarity and help those refugees and asylum seekers and to acknowledge their rights. It was interesting she actually acknowledged Costa Rica, because I know tonight at the United Nations University of Peace that the Earth Charter Secretariat will be watching tonight to be part of this gathering. To Dr. Tillam Ruff, thank you very much for the work you've done to acknowledge what has been a very dark part of our history, and that's the bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Let us pledge ourselves not to have this ever happen again. But to make this work something that I could not do, I'd like to first of all acknowledge the community of St. John's Cathedral and our staff here who have made this happen. Let's put our hands together and say thank you. To the University of Queensland and to Rotary, it's great to have you here to acknowledge our local agents of peace. Congratulations, and it's good to know that local people are being acknowledged for their work in our community. Peace begins with you and me. We are here as global citizens. Remember that. I'd also like to ask Leah if she would come up, please. And I know that Annette would love to give you just a little token of thank you for being part of our ceremony tonight. As long as we can use our talents to promote peace, that's what we've got to do. It was interesting that Gillian Triggs finished with going to the Bible, but I'd like to acknowledge all of our faiths. But I'd like to ask you to do something as a global citizen in your own way. I'd like you all to go out and be the Good Samaritan. Go out in your home, in your neighbourhood, and for those strangers, be prepared to pick them up. And let us all know that we can be good Samaritans. So, to all those peace groups, to members of the United Nations Association, Rotary, I'd like to say thank you very much for being part of a global audience to listen to Gillian Triggs and be part of our global citizenship promoting peace through the United Nations International Day of Peace. Thank you, one and all, and please thank you for everyone who's been participated to make this such a success. Thank you.